Hi everyone, welcome. My name is Bruce Wards. I have to thank everyone for the generous contributions for supporting this channel. Boom! Flash of light. But this time, we're in the constellations with my infrared camera. Yay! Finally! Guys, I'm going to get a lot of infrared camera. I'm doing it every night, every chance I get. And there's a problem. The snow, the freezing rain. Right now I'm in an ice storm and they're announcing it till Thursday tomorrow. So I stayed up extra late. Good morning, it's midnight. I stayed up extra late because I wanted your pity. No, because I love doing this work, guys. You don't have to beg me ever to stay up late. It's what I do. I love doing this research because it's so revealing. Every time I go out there, we're finding something. Look at this, a beautiful flash of light, probably a meteor, something going by, right? I got some UFOs going by, some unidentified flying objects recently, just yesterday, February 6th, before the darn storm. We're looking in the Milky Way, up towards the Milky Way, at a star cluster, and that's where I saw that flash of light. We are going to be able to get some meteors with this. That is so cool. You know, falling stars. But wait till I capture just the right one, as it'll go by and we'll get the long tail end. Maybe a comet, an asteroid. Not maybe. It's a matter of when and timing. You know, I'm starting to get familiar with the asteroids. Impossible to keep up with all of them. It's crazy. The asteroids that are all over the place. We heard NASA talking about asteroids that were in lower Earth's atmosphere, and now everything's hush-hush, right? People aren't talking about that anymore. But why were those asteroids attracted around Earth? And they still are, because in 3 years' time, look it up, guys, it tripled. Asteroids around Earth is crazy. Look at this. No, it ain't a plane. I don't care what you trolls are going to say. Guys, what do you think of this? The speed it's going, I have no idea. When you see a plane with an infrared camera, oh, I'm going to show you guys what it looks like. It is a flashing like mad, okay? You can see when it's a plane. All planes have lights. And with the infrared camera, it picks up the light. Trust me. You see that one go by? Isn't that just amazing? I think we're in Hercules, right? Well, I hope so. It looks like the star cluster. Sometimes the constellations all look the same, but I think, yeah, we're in Hercules right there. This is that beautiful flash of light that I was able to capture just yesterday. So all of this, guys, took about, I'd say about 40 minutes, 45 minutes. That's the amount of time that I was filming. So we're going to go see now what I got. Okay. Listen, guys, bear with me. I was using my free hand. I bought all this equipment during the winter. So even the D850 Nikon, amazing 46 megapixel camera, I'm not able to use it entirely to its full capacity yet. Just wait in a couple of days, weeks, yeah. We're in winter. It's February. Check this out. This was the first time. And now I'm going to explain to you why I'm using it handheld. Because, look, I'm finding them. If you put it on a tripod, you're going to see what goes by in front of your tripod. But this was the first test. But look, guys, okay, bear with me. Sorry for the shakiness, but it's great footage. I'm capturing all these objects. Now, everything here in front of you is moving, by the way. There's only one star in the entire frame. The other ones are moving slower, and this object whizzing by, another one's going to come into the frame. There's definitely a UFO corridor right over Earth, and we see them going by. I guess, depending on which country you are in, you know, it's going to be different. The types of UFOs that we're going to be seeing in different countries are going to be different. Probably, no doubt, you know, because here in Montreal, they say it's the UFO capital. They're all over the place, but guys, they're so fast, you have to really slow down the footage. So what are these things? You know, they're not going by at incredible speeds compared to the ones that we see. But hang on, they're far. It always comes down to that distance. Look at this. Top left is one. Right, another one just came into the view. So this is repetitive. With the infrared camera, guys, it's incredible. We see everything that our eyes don't see. So I kept spending my time putting the camera down and trying to look with a Nikon camera beside me saying, how come I'm not seeing any of this? It's almost near impossible. Well, it's not, because our eyes can see, like I told you, 380 nanometers to 700 nanometers. So this is 700 nanometers to 1 millimeter. So it's up in the infrared spectrum, and we're only going to see it with an infrared camera. So the coming days and weeks, every night that I can get clear nights, Friday they're announcing 10 degrees. Don't worry, guys, I'll be out.
This is an infrared camera.
So what can it see? You know, what can our eyes see, and why do I use an infrared camera? Because we're seeing things in a spectrum, the infrared spectrum, that our eyes are not capable of seeing. We see in the visible spectrum, you know, the portion of the electromagnetic spectrum that is visible to the human eye. Well, the electromagnetic radiation in that range of wavelength is called visible light, or just simply light. A typical human eye will respond to wavelengths from 380 to 740 nanometers. Look up the electromagnetic spectrum if you want to get the entire range of frequencies and their colors.
So it wasn't enough that I had to learn about physics. Infrared spectroscopy. You have to look this up. And at the same time, get an idea and a notion of infrared. The infrared portion of the electromagnetic spectrum is usually divided into three regions. You have the near infrared, the mid, and far infrared. At rare times, scientific phenomena permit us to see the infrared spectrum without a filter.
A lunar wave, two at that, actually three. Two strong enough ones and one very weak. You want to see what a lunar wave looks like in great detail? Check out Crow 777. Everyone knows that, you know, you've all seen it. His lunar wave video, check it out. Guys, this is a lunar wave repeating itself. There's another one following behind it, and it happened in 3 seconds, and I never saw it again. Now look carefully. This is not oscillation. It's not something that's going back and forth. I'm the one that's doing the back and forth right now. I'm going ahead and back, so you can see this wave rolling by. We could almost see a physical line, okay? That's how concentrated it is, okay? Lunar waves, Crow 777 got it really concentrated, okay? It's a black line as it's moving across the moon. Now, I saw the entire screen, this lunar wave. I don't know if it was the entire moon, because of course I wasn't zoomed out, okay? But still documenting it. I've never seen it again. We probably will. This was on June 4th, 2018. The Terminator line is just above Mons Argeas. What am I pointing at? It looks like a tunnel. It looks like a straight structure. It's overlapped by three parts. It goes straight through here, alongside of Mare Serenitatis, Mare Serenitatis. What does Mare mean? It means water. Yep, that's what they called it a long time ago, because, you know, we were told they were naive and thought they were lakes. What if they are? So, check it out. Look even closer, okay, along the Terminator line. That's the direction of the object, we'll just call it. Looks unnatural, okay? It looks very unnatural. And Mare Imbrium is right here. So right over here is where Apollo 11 landed, just across from the Apollo 17. Well, just across the size of Mare Imbrium. We'll talk size in a few seconds. It's just so amazing, isn't it? That we have all the information of where we come from and how space was created, and it's just amazing being able to read and not having to use our brains. They say Mare Imbrium may have been formed when a protoplanet in the asteroid belt collided with the moon 3.8 billion years ago on a Friday. No, I added the Friday to make it even sound even more crazy. How could they even know that? It's theory. Science, so long me, is theory itself. Science itself is theory. So how big is Mare Imbrium, the diameter of Mare Imbrium? We're talking 1,145 kilometers and 711.47 miles. What is that? A triangle. It is a triangle. I'm not going to tell me it's not a triangle. Look at it. It's out of place. It's out of context with the entire surface of the moon. Seriously. Okay? That's an object that also looks like it could be standing. So what we're going to do is we're going to flip it around. Look at this. This is Aristarchus Crater. See the rectangle around Copernicus Crater on the bottom there? Just on the bottom of Aristarchus Crater. Not hard to see, and I just so many squares and rectangles and triangles and circles on the surface of the moon. Check it out. Isn't it incredible? It's triangular. It's out of place. It's dark. It's not a shadow. Come on, guys. I'm sorry there. What's making that shadow? I'd love somebody to try to ridicule me by telling me that it's a shadow. We know that's not a shadow. Even though we don't know what it is, we do know it's not a shadow. And that's just my opinion. Mikhail Briner, thanks for the generous donations, man. Robert Goudreau, Ronna Kennedy, Harold Hughes. Harold, I'll be in touch, brother. Guys, I got to thank you all for the generous donations and help and support to this channel. Robert Down, welcome and thanks for the generous contributions, bro. Looking forward to interact with you.